Hi guys, it's Tammy with NurseMinder, and today we're talking about pulses and what you need to know when you talk about them, chart them, and communicate about them. And we're going to take care of that right after this. Welcome back. My name is Tammy and this is NurseMinder, and on this channel we do everything nursing. So if you're new here, consider subscribing below so that you get the next video when it's released. Welcome back. My name is Tammy and today we're talking about pulses. A typical conversation in clinical practice goes something like this.
Hey, you've done a really good job at giving me your patient's head to toe assessment, but I just want to go back to the pulses. Can you tell me about them again?
Yeah, like their pulses were good.
What is good?
Like I felt them in both arms and like they're equal and I didn't have any troubles finding them.
Could you give me a number? Like what does that mean? Could you give me a number?
A number?
You know, like have you ever heard of a pulse grading scale?
You mean like out of five?
All right, I think maybe we need to talk a little bit more.
We're gonna talk about several different pulse sites, and the ones in particular that most nurses on the floor would be focused on. But typically on a med-surg floor, the nurses would be focused on the radial pulse and the dorsalis pedis pulse. So we're gonna focus on those two, but we'll talk about where all the others are as well.
We're gonna begin at the head and work our way down to the toes. So we're gonna start with the carotid pulse.
To locate the carotid pulse, we're looking at the one that is in the neck. This is the one people are most familiar with because we've all likely had an opportunity to check our pulse. If you haven't had the opportunity, I'm gonna show you a few different ways to find the carotid pulse. The first is we have the trachea. The first is the trachea, here is midline, and if you were to find the trachea and just gently roll your fingers back, you'll find some resistance. That's the sternocleidomastoid muscle, this big muscle here, and it's going to be in that groove that you find the carotid pulse.
Alternatively, you can find the angle of the jaw and then just bring your fingers straight down and you will be in the groove between the sternocleidomastoid muscle and the trachea. The second pulse point we're going to talk about is the brachial pulse.
So in the patient's arm, we're often palpating the brachial pulse because that's what we're looking for when we do blood pressure. And it's on the medial side. So if you find this is one of the veins here that you can see, that's not an artery. And you know that because when you put your fingers over it, there is no pulse sensation. There's no waveform. But if you come off into the medial, you'll often be able to find it sitting in here. And you shouldn't have to apply too heavy of a pressure to find the brachial pulse. Now, right after the elbow, the brachial pulse bifurcates or divides into two different arteries, main arteries, one being the radial, which is on the thumb side. It's always right to be radial. And then on the left side is the ulnar. We typically do not palpate the ulnar at the bedside for nursing, but this is used in intensive care and by a respiratory therapist when they're completing an Allen test. Now you've probably taken your own pulse before and just used two fingers and it goes in between the groove here. Slight gentle pressure and you should be able to feel a pulse. I find if you're having a hard time finding your pulses that if you were to hyperextend their wrist, it will bring the vessel closer to the surface and you'll maybe be able to find that easier. It's a good activity to try on your own. Put your light pressure, extend the wrist and see how that changes the pressure that you feel for each of those pulse forms.
Moving to the lower extremities, we see the femoral artery, which we will not be demonstrating, the popliteal artery, which is behind the kneecap, and then the dorsalis pedis and posterior tibialis, which we will focus on next. The dorsalis pedis pulse is the one that is on the top surface of your foot, at the arch. To locate the dorsalis pedis, start with your finger at the gap in between your two large toes. Draw a line straight up to the arch of your foot. Plant your two fingers and then gently roll in or out. You may find that your patient's pulse will be on either side of that arch. Just to demonstrate it from the side, again, trace your finger up from the gap of the two toes, apply gentle pressure and rock your fingers on either side of the arch.
Now in clinical, when your patients are laying there and their feet are relaxed, you may find that it's easier to hold their feet in your hands. Once you've got your spot, don't be shy to put your thumb there to rest against and then put their feet back into an anatomical position to find that pulse a little stronger. Posterior tibialis. Posterior means behind tibia. So the tibia is on the midline. And so we're going to actually I'll come to the side here to show you. There's the tibial malleolus. We want to be posterior to it, and you put your fingers right in that groove and you should be able to feel a strong pulse. Okay.
You know, when it comes to assessing the pulse, there's a few things we're looking for. Number one is we're looking to see, is my pulse regular or irregular? And I tend to like to palpate both of my patients' wrists at the same time, and I'm just palpating at that time to determine if they are similar or dissimilar and if the pulse is regular. So this is what I'm feeling. I'm mimicking feeling a pulse here. I'm not having a conversation. If this is what I'm palpating,
this is a regular rhythm.
If it were to be irregular, so instead of having this nice regular pattern, it's now interrupted every once in a while with another funky beat. I want to know, is it a regular irregular or just an irregular? So what are the differences? A regular irregular pattern has a predictability about it, meaning it will go lub, 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 lub. Blah, blah. You can predict that pattern over and over. An irregular, irregular pattern is one that has no predictability. So you might have a lub, lub, la, lub, 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 la, lub, 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 li, lub. And so nothing, you can't predict what's going to happen next. Those are the two differences between regular versus irregular. The next thing I want to know is my grading. Is it a 1 plus, a 2 plus, a 3 plus, or a 4 plus? Depending on your facility, you might just be using 1 to 3 or 1 to 4. A 1 plus is a faint pulse. You know those times you're like, oh my gosh, do I even have a pulse? And you got to press a little bit harder to find it. That's a 1 plus. A 2 plus is your normal activity, walking around, chasing after the dog. And you can feel your pulse with just light pressure.
Now, it's not easily obliterated, but it can be done with some pressure.
A 3 plus is bounding, so like we've just run a whole marathon, our body is pumping, and it kind of feels that same way in our radial pulse or other pulse sites too. And so it's almost as if your fingers are popping up with it.
If you put a moderate amount of effort into obliterating that pulse, you could probably do so, but it would take a bit.
And now a 4 plus is a pulse you cannot obliterate. It's just bounding. You feel it with every pulse, no matter what you do to that for pressure. And then the last thing, of course, is the rate. You need to count it. And most facilities will do a 10 or 15 second check. If it's a regular rhythm, then you can do your multiplication factor. If it is irregular, you need to complete a full minute pulse check. So the next time someone asks you what your patient's pulses are, good is not the right answer. You want to be able to tell them that the regular 2 plus times 4 limbs, if that's the case. Until next time, guys, make it a great day.